Hey, good morning, guys. I get a feeling that most of the people who watch my videos are considered the go-to person of the family when it comes to fixing things that go wrong. Through the years, we've all gotten pretty good at recognizing and dealing with common problems. For example, the slow crank of a starter motor on a cold day with a dying battery is characteristic and a pretty easy diagnosis. But these days, cars are more like computers than engines of the past, and common presentations can be very different. Today I'm going to show you how to recognize the most common cause of a disabled hybrid vehicle and maybe even give you the confidence to get a stranger back on the road. The first thing to realize is how different these vehicles really are. There's no dedicated starter motor, and instead they've got a huge and powerful electric motor driven by the main engine battery, not the accessory battery. And instead of an alternator, that same system is used to regenerate power to recharge both the accessory battery and the main engine battery. The accessory battery still does power the electronics, and it's used for many of the electronic relays, including those responsible for lighting and safety. And because those safety relays need adequate power from the accessory battery, the manufacturers have built in a safety lockout that prevents starting when the accessory battery is underpowered or disconnected. In that event, the rear battery is automatically dropped into a kind of lockout mode that isolates the main battery. That same lockout mechanism is designed to be in place after a collision, so that the high tension wires are less likely to be live after a motor vehicle accident. So if you can't rely on slow cranking or dim lights, how do you recognize a depleted accessory battery in a hybrid vehicle?
Well, as is often the case, your first clue is usually in the history. You might have left a car door open or a light on or something like that, and when you go to start, you get nothing, or you get these flashing lights in the dash. Now, the first time this happened to us, my wife called me from a parking lot on the coldest day of the year, and she said when she turned the key, she'd get these bright red flashing lights on the dash. Just because of the temperature and the time of year, I thought, let's see if it's an accessory battery. So I drove over with booster cables and my multimeter.
To get at the accessory battery, you need to remove this cover plate, take off this plastic tab and this plastic tab. To do that, you press in this little centerpiece and then pry up on the tab. After exposing the battery, I tested static voltage, which measured 10.5 volts, and then I asked her to turn the start key, and my multimeter dropped to 9.1 volts across the poles. I boosted the battery, and she was on her way. Of course, that nicely proved the battery was inadequately charged, but it does not prove the battery was bad. Formal battery testing requires a load test after checking electrolyte levels and a full recharge, but what I did at the roadside was enough to get the vehicle back at the shop. Once I had the vehicle home, I removed the battery, topped up the distilled water in each cell, and then rewarmed and recharged the battery slowly overnight with an AC battery charger. Then I did a load test using this carbon pile load tester. If you don't have one of these, they're available for free use at any auto parts store. The battery failed, so I replaced it.
You know, some days I can be a real doofus.
Here's another common situation. If you're a veteran car user, you may make the mistake that I've been stupid enough to make more than once. You're in a lineup for a ferry and you want to listen to the radio but not waste gas by running the engine. So you make the fatal mistake of turning the key to ACC or on without starting the engine. I'm going to demonstrate for you how in this vehicle that can be a big mistake.
Now, because you don't need a large power output from the accessory battery, it's a lot smaller and underpowered compared to older vehicles. Unfortunately, that same quality means the accessory battery doesn't have much reserve when it fails. So accessory battery failure is surprisingly common. Today I've hooked up my induction ammeter to the positive pole here just to measure output at various key positions in the ignition. Now look at this ignition key spot. If you'll see, there's lock and there's ACC to the right of lock. In most vehicles the ACC is to the left, but in this case it's to the right, and then on and start. And so if you're going to have the vehicle sit without running the engine, then you want to be very careful that it's on ACC and not on. Just for kicks, I wanted to measure my amp draw with the key turned to the ACC option in the ignition and with the radio on. Everything else is off. The lights are all off. You can see I'm drawing a fair amount, 5.5 amps of current, just with the radio on, and so there's a fair amount of draw on this little battery, even using the ACC option.
It's pretty obvious it's more than just a radio drawing all that current. Here I am after 15 minutes of just running the radio with the ignition set to ACC and with everything else off, and the current draw is still 4.2 amps. It doesn't take long before the voltage of that little accessory battery is depleted, but the worst part of this is you'll likely get no warning it's going to happen. Most of the time the radio just suddenly dies and the info screen goes blank, and then your only option is to beg a bystander for a quick engine off boost.
Well, here it is with the key on the ACC position, and you can hear the radio, and you can see the lights are not on. But if we turn the switch just one click, we get to on, and all of a sudden everything else powers up. And so our amp draw is significantly higher with this. Here's our amp draw with the key turned to on. Pretty high. So this is what you get when you start a hybrid normally. Notice that you can barely hear the engine turning over, and so crank speed isn't going to help you. And turning the start key might not even immediately start the engine, depending on the state of charge and the ambient temperature.
Well, so far I've talked about why hybrids are vulnerable to accessory battery depletion and how to make that diagnosis. Once you come up with a probable diagnosis, the next challenge is the boost. Is there anything special about boosting a hybrid? Well, yes and no.
Ironically, hybrid manufacturers don't permit you to manually boost the accessory battery from the main battery, even though there's plenty of power hidden underneath the back seat. Trying to manually boost from there would be a huge mistake since the voltage is dangerously higher.
Well, here's a funny and frustrating design feature. If you store your booster cables with a spare tire, you need to get into here. And this door, even if you want to use it manually, is electric. So you're not going to be able to get in here with the power on. You need to crawl through the back seat.
The good news is that you boost the accessory battery pretty much exactly the same way you do with a normal vehicle. And you follow the same specific order that we all memorized at automotive school. First, you hook up to the stalled vehicle's hot pole, then the donor's hot side, then the donor's ground, and then finally hook up to the stalled vehicle's engine. Lexus emphasized that the donor vehicle should not be running when you boost. In conventional vehicles, that can be a problem because of the huge amp draw when trying to quickly charge and start a disabled vehicle. But because the small Lexus battery doesn't power the starter, the risk of draining the donor battery is lower. I believe Lexus don't want the donor vehicle running because they want to avoid damage to sensitive electronics caused by voltage pulsations from the donor vehicle's alternator. And they don't need the typical 14.5 volts seen in a running vehicle. 12 volts is fine.
Well, guys, I think I've learned my lesson. These days, if I want to listen to the radio in a parked hybrid, I leave the engine on completely and I let the computer decide whether the engine should be running or not. The computer automatically detects that the engine is not being used, and so it'll turn it off. But importantly, it measures voltage, and as that accessory voltage falls, the computer can restart the engine before the voltage falls far enough to require a manual boost. Well, anybody who owns a hybrid will tell you that accessory battery problems are high on the list for sudden causes of vehicle failure. Even if you don't own one, I hope this video has made you feel more confident in helping somebody else on the roadside if called to. So if I earned your like today, then let me know. Feedback makes it easier for others to find these videos. Thanks for watching.